30 years have passed now, but I'm still extremely proud of Dr. Zhivago and what all of us, workers, actors, and technicians, did to bring Pasternak's saga to the screen. When we worked on the film in 1965, Dr. Zhivago, the book, was still banned in the Soviet Union. It wasn't until Gorbachev and Glasnost that it was finally published in the original Russian. The film wasn't officially allowed to be seen until even later, 1994. Please join us now as we present the making of Dr. Zhivago, behind-the-scenes look at the meticulous work and craft that went into the production.
That David Lean was going to make a film of Dr. Zhivago, I immediately got the book and started reading it to find if there was a part for me. I never imagined that they would ask me to play the title role because, you know, I thought people knew me as an Arab riding a camel and wouldn't think of me as a Russian poet. And I found the part which I thought was suitable for me. And I called my agent and said to go and see David Lean and ask him if he would allow me to play that part. It's the part that Tom Courtney played eventually, Pasha. And then he called me back, he said, David doesn't agree about you playing Pasha, but would you consider the title role?
In 1965, Zhivago is one of the most expensive movies ever made, $15 million. But it was also a huge moneymaker for Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. The man who made it, British director David Lean, was a master at capturing the vast scale of an entire period in history.
He was a great narrator, and I don't think anyone else could tell it better. Maybe one or two other directors could have told it as well.
When Zhivago was released in December 1965, everything from the costumes to the music caught the public's attention. I can remember how the Zhivago look became high fashion, and how many baby girls born in the late 60s were suddenly named Lara. The mustache made a big comeback, and Maurice Jarre's Lara's theme was a worldwide hit everyone was humming.
I wanted to have that most romantic look, which Pasternak actually had himself. I took off about half an inch of my hairline, waxed it off, which is very painful. You have to do it about once every 3 or 4 days. And I had a wig made, a bit of hair falling on the side, because my hair is typically Egyptian. You know, I have slightly roundish eyes and they're a little down. So I pulled here a bit to try and be a little more Slav, you know, get a little cheekbones going. But, you know, it's painful. And this is for a whole year we had to shoot. And they used to just stick two things here and put an elastic thing and make it very tight and just to pain you here. And after a few months you get a scar, you know, in the place where it stuck with. It did make a difference. I mean, I think it was right. The makeup was good.
Yuri Zhivago is a poet and a man of peace who must come to terms with the turmoil that uproots his home, his family, and his country. Zhivago becomes a doctor in pre-revolutionary Moscow and marries Tonya, played by Charlie Chaplin's then 20-year-old daughter, Geraldine Chaplin. The funny thing is, Mr. Lean had first spotted Geraldine on a magazine cover.
And there'd been a huge amount of publicity because I was Charlie Chaplin's daughter and I was doing this ballet in Paris and I was the chouchou of all the Parisiens and I was on the cover of every magazine. And he picked up a magazine which he normally wouldn't look at. And he thought, yeah, she looks Russian. Oh, Charlie Chaplin's daughter, good for publicity. I'll try her.
Test 11, take one.
This was her screen test.
But now the war seems really to have stopped. The hospital is emptying and I shall have more time. I may even get time to write some verse, if I've not forgotten how to.
After reviewing it, David Lean sent this gracious letter to her parents, Charlie and Una, extolling her acting virtues.
He said everyone was impressed, and then he said at the end, he said, it's a wonderful part, and I hope she'll do it.
Geraldine patterned the role of Tonya after her own mother, Una O'Neill, the daughter of American playwright Eugene O'Neill.
Tonya is my mother, very much. There still are, I mean, I think, women like that who give themselves completely to a man who's an artist. Tonya thinks that Yuri is a poet. Maybe he wasn't a great poet, but she thinks her whole life she's giving to this artist. And I modeled myself completely on my mother, who married my father when she was 17 and gave her whole life to him and to his art.
Oh, I bought you this. It has a piece in it about young Russian poets.
Oh, good. Thank you. Does it mention me?
But after marrying Tonya, Zhivago will have another love enter his life. The beautiful Lara, portrayed by Julie Christie. Julie was born in India, the daughter of a British tea planter, and was later educated in England.
The winner is Julie Christie.
She would win an Oscar for her role in Darling, the film she made just before we started Zhivago. But Julie was still a relative newcomer in 1964 when she caught David's eye for the way she swung a purse in another film, Billy Liar.
How old are you now?
When Zhivago first meets Lara, she's entangled with her mother's lover, the worldly aristocratic womanizer Komarovsky, played by the only American in the movie, Rod Steiger.
He didn't do anything wrong. He wanted to sleep with both women. I don't know a man in the world who wouldn't want to sleep with two women at once. He didn't do anything wrong. In fact, he was a romantic and kind of heroic at the end.
Rod had his own unique way of helping Julie play her role, such as the scene in the sleigh on the way back from the ball.
And I'm supposed to kiss her, and she's supposed to be shocked because she doesn't know it's coming. But Julie was nervous, and she was kind of tense, so you could always feel she was anticipating the kiss. So we did it a couple of times, and we were having a little trouble. And I said, I'd like to talk to you a minute, Mr. Lee. Oh, really, yes? What about? You know. So I said, could I talk to you alone? Yes, of course. What is it? I said, you know, I have an idea. Oh, really? And I said, you know, what you should do is, you know, we have the track down and the camera's on the track. We come around the corner and then we go on the track like a little railroad. I said, what you should do is lay down about 10, 12 feet more track. And I'll come around the corner and I'll kiss her. She'll expect that. And she thinks the shot is over. Then I'll grab her, put my tongue down her throat. And you'll get what you want. And we did it, and of course we got it in one. I don't think he ever, ever forgave me.
Pasha, are you a Bolshevik?
No.
Lara has another man in her life, the passionate student turned revolutionary, Pasha, played by Tom Courtney. Tom was nominated for Best Supporting Actor for portraying the metamorphosis of Pasha, the young idealist, into the dreaded strong man of the steppes, Strelnikov.
Geraldine joins the distinguished cast of...
Rounding out this top-notch international cast were Sir Ralph Richardson as Tonya's father,
Brotherhood and Freedom,
Ireland's best-known actress at the time, Siobhan McKenna, as Tonya's mother, and Sir Alec Guinness, who plays Zhivago's half-brother Yevgraf, and who serves as a sort of guide through the story. Although they did not always see eye to eye, David considered Alec his good luck charm because of the success of their previous work together in Bridge on the River Kwai and, of course, Lawrence of Arabia.
When you're with a man who can make a movie like that and he can get the best people who want to work with him, there's very little trouble. I mean, you don't have to say much to Guinness or Mr. Guinness or Mr. Richardson or other people. We all had experience.
Watch carefully. I'm about to ignite the last half of the last cigar in Moscow.
In a remote corner of Indochina, one of the world's outstanding filmmakers, David Lean.
The director of Dr. Zhivago is David Lean, a master storyteller and film craftsman who had already won Academy Awards for directing Bridge on the River Kwai and Lawrence of Arabia. David Lean's career started out modestly enough. He apprenticed in every department of the Gaumont British Film Studio, but quickly rose to become one of the world's most respected directors, one of the rare few who could put together a movie as massive as Zhivago. I first worked with David when we spent a year making Lawrence in Jordan, England, and Spain.
He loved cinema more than anything. He breathed and lived cinema. And when he was on the set, he was all cinema. There was no chats about other things or jokes. It was a religious, a little bit, set, you know. It was awesome.
He was a wonderful movie maker and very loyal to his crew. He had a prop man who was a genius. He was a Cockney named Eddie. And he was with Lean, and Lean has his own generosity in his own way. And Eddie was always enamored of Mr. Lean's Rolls Royce. One day, Mr. Lean just gave it to him.
We weren't friends during the film, because he had this theory that you don't see the actors during the film. He'd always live in another hotel. He wouldn't be with us. He wouldn't see us outside of shooting. And I asked him afterwards, I said, but why? Why we're such good friends now? He said, I didn't want, you were a group of people with very, very strong personalities, and I did not want your personalities to influence the characters that I have in my head for this movie. And so I didn't want to see any of you.
David was a perfectionist, a real stickler for details. Everything from having the actors wear period underwear that would never be seen to giving the rats in the scene a screen test.
I don't think David Lean liked me very much after a while. Everybody approached the script like it was the Bible, right?
One of the wonderful things about David Lean, one of the things I most admire about him, is he never gave up until he got what he wanted. And sometimes he didn't know how to get it. But he knew always what he didn't want, and there were no compromises. And I think that's a great lesson.
And nothing would stop David from shooting, not even an accident on the set.
The woman who comes running with the baby in the burnt village, and she gives the baby, and Zhivago takes the baby and then takes her and reaches out his hand towards her and reaches and pulls her on the train. Well, we did that in a real station with a real train, the train running. And he took her hand and she went under. She went under the train and she got her legs very badly. They weren't cut off, but they were really badly. And the shot that's in the film where he puts out his hand and he brings her up, and that is the shot where she went down. He used that. And everyone hated David Lean the day after that, because you know what he did? He said, well, what could you do? They took her out, they rushed her to the ambulance, and David just stood there and he said, dress the double. And we continued with the double, and everyone said, you know, how dare, but what could he, you're making a movie, what could he do? Call the day's rest? No, he said, dress the double.
Perhaps David didn't show it on the set, but privately, he was very concerned about the woman and made many phone calls to the hospital asking about her. Despite his immense success as a filmmaker, David could never quite believe his good fortune, and always considered himself rather lucky to have had the chance to make his movies. At his funeral in April 1991, I was one of hundreds who gathered to pay tribute to him. For my part, I read a passage from Dr. Zhivago.
Thank you. bourgeois terms, it was a war between the Allies and Germany. In Bolshevik terms, it was a war between the Allied and German upper classes. And which of them won was a matter of indifference.
Zhivago is filled with the politics and the massive social upheaval of revolutionary Russia. The characters are formed by the madness and the warfare that swirls around them.
Are you the poet?
Yes.
I used to admire your poetry.
Thank you.
I shouldn't admire it now.
For us on the set, this was only a story. But for the author of the book on which the film is based, all this was very real.
There is quite a lot of autobiography in Dr. Zhivago. It's very much linked to Pasternak's life.
Just like his fictional hero, Pasternak was a poet who lived through Russia's revolutionary times. And just like Zhivago, Pasternak came to love two women at the same time.
Pasternak was a romantic, and I don't think he meant really to write a political book. I mean, it was political by accident. He put this love story in the context of this enormous upheaval, which was the Russian Revolution.
Boris Leonidovich Pasternak was born in Moscow in 1890 into a cultured, middle-class Jewish family of professional artists. He published his first collection of poems a year after this photo was taken in 1917, the same year that the Russian Revolution broke out. As the years went by, Pasternak's reputation as a poet grew. And so did his willingness to question what he saw around him. Not a good thing in the young Soviet state. By the 1930s, he was no longer able to publish what he wrote. Just as Zhivago, Pasternak was informed that his work diverged from the socialist mandates of the time.
So I told him what I had heard about his poems.
Not liked. Not like by whom?
During these lean years out of official literary favor, Pasternak made a living translating the works of Shakespeare and the English Romantics. His second wife, Zinaida, inspired much of his poetry, and she was the basis for Zhivago's wife in the film, Geraldine's character, Tonya. But it was a woman whom Pasternak met in 1946. Who inspired the love of Zhivago's life, Lara. Here, this is the real Lara, in an interview in 1993. Her name is Olga Ivinskaya, and soon after Pasternak met her, she became his mistress.
The very next day, he visited me personally and brought me a few poetry books, which I didn't have yet. And then began, how should I express it, an orgy of feelings. Very soon he could no longer live without me, and I no longer without him. I understood how difficult this was for him. On the one hand, he could no longer be without me. On the other, he didn't want to leave his family.
The year he met Olga, Pasternak began writing Dr. Zhivago. It would take him 10 years to finish.
It is obvious in the novel that he gave the character of Tonya the endearing characteristics of his own wife, Zinaida. One reason for his deep bond with her. That's clearly obvious. Most important, however, was that he said that Lara, that's me, was the woman for his aging days.
Pasternak's two previous books had been banned. Now he could only pass the manuscript for Zhivago hand to hand among his friends and literary acquaintances. Then, in 1957, Zhivago, the book, was smuggled out of the Soviet Union by an admirer, Italian publisher Gian Giacomo Feltrinelli, who published it in Italian. It soon came to the attention of the rest of the world. In 1958, the Swedish Nobel Committee awarded Pasternak its prize for literature for his masterpiece.
The Nobel Prize for Literature.
When Pasternak first found out, he was elated. But after Soviet officials told him he would not be allowed to return to Russia if he went to Stockholm to accept his prize, Pasternak sent the Nobel Committee this telegram.
In light of the significance this award carries in the society in which I live, I must renounce the undeserved prize which was awarded to me. Please do not be offended by my voluntary refusal.
Pasternak chose to sacrifice the honor because of his tremendous love for his country.
He refused to be an exile. He loved Russia so much. I don't think I've ever heard of anyone who loved Russia so much. He didn't mean to criticize. I think he was shocked when they told him this book is anti-Soviet.
Two years later, Pasternak was dead. It would be another quarter century before his epic masterpiece would be published in his mother tongue. Olga, his mistress, paid the price for her relationship with Pasternak. She was forced to spend two prison sentences in a Soviet work camp.
Ну что еще можно сказать?
What should I say? It was purely love, but a love for which you pay dearly. I've paid very dearly since our first meeting. I would like to answer the question why they sent me and not him to the camp in this way. The government wanted to punish him indirectly, through me. They hoped that the pain they inflicted on me would cause him to give in. They could get the better of him in this way.
Oh, Lord, this is an awful time to be alive.
No.
It is. It is.
No, no.
I have many Russian friends who have seen the film in Russia. I mean, they got videos maybe or whatever. But the book is allowed now. People read it. Everybody has read it in Russia. It's a good book. Once you get over the first 100 pages, look all the names, who is who, then it becomes wonderful.
It was Italian producer Carlo Ponti who succeeded in bringing Pasternak's masterpiece to the screen. Carlo had bought the rights to Zhivago from Feltrinelli because he wanted his wife, Sophia Loren, to play the role of Lara. But once he had the property, he still needed a big studio like MGM to make it.
And I think it was difficult to finance because, it had to be a big production. Eventually, the studio said, well, if you could get David Lean, we'll go through with it. And David said, I'll make this picture, but I can't use Sophia because she's too tall, too big. He saw Larissa as a smaller person. He didn't want someone that tall. So eventually Carlo agreed and they got the financing and that's how it was put together. Then David had carte blanche, he wanted to choose everything. And the studios did allow him to do whatever he wanted.
After Lawrence, David Lean was drawn to Pasternak's Dr. Zhivago.
David had read Zhivago on a sea voyage after finishing Lawrence and immediately wanted to make Pasternak's epic his next project. One of the first things he did was to gather together the same team who had worked on Lawrence, including gifted British playwright Robert Bolt, who had written the screenplay for Man for All Seasons and Lawrence, and distinguished set designer John Box.
I read it and then went to Venice just to talk about it, and we must have spent at least 10 days just discussing it, analyzing it. What was the very essence of this film? And he said, John, it's fundamentally a marvelous story about human beings. I don't want to treat it as a political film. I want to treat it the way I know I can handle the film, which is the human factors. And obviously, Robert Bolt was to help him considerably in the writing of the script.
and I then know why.
Robert did a marvelous job on the screenplay and won an Academy Award for his efforts. In 1979, Robert suffered a stroke which affected his speech. He died in February 1995. The first edict Mr. Lean gave to Robert was to focus on the love story aspect of Pasternak's mammoth novel and downplay the politics.
I said, but it isn't just a love story, it is a love story about the revolution. How do we get that in? And he said, well, that is what I am expecting from you.
David and Robert sat down and spent an entire year paring down what was essentially a 700-page poem into a manageable 284-page screenplay.
Well, I must say that the script is beautifully written, and so it was perfect. The script is perfect.
The extraordinary thing in that film, in that script, is that this is a love story between Yuri Zhivago and Lara, basically. And they don't meet until about 2 hours into the film. You know, they cross paths. The first time we see them, they're on the same streetcar, they're on the same tram, but they don't meet. So to keep the audience interested, they are going to meet. This is going to be a love story about these two. They wrote this first scene where Alec Guinness, who is the elder brother of Zhivago, is looking for the daughter. And he says, this is your father and this is your mother, so that the audience know that eventually they will meet, just to keep them patient for 2 hours.
Once the script was underway, David and John Box packed their bags for a 10,000-mile location scouting expedition. Finding locations proved especially difficult, because as you can see from the sketches John Box drew before production began, Zhivago covers so many places, so many years, and all the seasons.
You can't create a landscape, you've got to find it and make it work. There's certain basic principles about Dr. Zhivago. It is set in Russia. That's a big country. The scale is critical for telling this very particular story. And then there's the practical issue. You've got to have locomotives, steam locomotives.
Now!
You've got to have a lot of horses. You're going to need a lot of fine riders. And it's a film, because Russia's a big place, there's a lot of people there. You need big crowds.
Deserters.
Replacements. We started in Yugoslavia, had a film business, had studios, had steam locomotives. It did not feel right. And this word feel is very important, because it's atmosphere. It's not just sets or location. You've got to create a world in which actors play out those parts. And you've got to help the actors. It does help them if you get it right. We next move north, Finland and Sweden, obviously for winter and for snow. They didn't have the studios, this, that and the other we would require, because we were a big movie. So back I come to David and tell him it won't work. He's questioned, John, where are we going to make this film? And I looked him straight in the eyeball and said, Spain.
Spain offered studio facilities within easy reach of landscapes that Zhivago would need.
It has the size, it has the scale we require, it has the locomotive, it has extras, it has sophisticated construction and technical people there. And it would look excellent on the screen.
And Moscow rose anew outside Madrid.
It was here, on this 10-acre site in the small Madrid suburb called Cañas, that John Box recreated Zhivago's Moscow. It took 18 months and 800 workers to construct the giant set. The Kremlin dominated streets that even featured two working trolley lines. The architecture and even the window dressing were all painstakingly researched and recreated.
Yuri!
It was incredible, because the two streets, there was the big street, the beautiful street, and then there were the poor street where Laura lived, and there were two streets that were parallel. And all the houses, you know how mostly film sets, they're just, you look behind them and there are bits of sticks coming out. All the houses were real houses. All the interiors of our house, the Gromyko house, were shot on that set.
With a horse-drawn sleigh, the bygone Moscow of the early 1900s makes a striking setting for photographers and journalists from all corners of the world who come to photograph and interview Geraldine Chaplin.
For the scenes in the countryside, the production moved 150 miles north of Madrid to Soria. Here's Julie sunning herself while we wait to shoot the wagon caravan scene.
It was unbelievable. So you'd be outside on this plain in Soria. So hot, I can't tell you. Not a tree, nothing, except the false trees, which were for the film.
Soria was also where Dr. Zhivago's most recognizable set was built, the hauntingly beautiful Ice Palace.
The amazing thing in that picture to me is the Ice Palace, which is made out of beeswax. I mean, John Box, the designer, was incredible on that picture.
Highly emotional. These two key characters come back there, and they go in. What are they going to find in there? I didn't really know how to handle it, but then I suddenly saw some reference of Scott's last days in the Antarctic in the room, and it showed quite a small hole, and the wind had blown the snow and ice through it, and the snow and ice had made strange shapes, and that gave me my clue. Take the set. It's going to be a bit unreal, but it's going to be real at the same time. Ice it up. And I go to Eddie Fowley in props, special effects and everything. We just did it very simply. We had very hot white wax. Eddie went round with a bucket and a big mug and he threw it all over the architecture, the furniture and everything else. When I thought it looked right, I hit it with nearly freezing water with a pump. So it just froze. And dabbed a bit of mica on later and that sort of thing. Seemed to work. It had an effect on the actors.
We needed to shoot in that particular place the four seasons. So we had to shoot scenes where it was winter, all snowed up. We had some spring scenes, so we had the people, the special effects had to put leaves on the trees and paint them green and put flowers. And then we had the autumn, and then they went to paint the leaves in the autumn colors. So it was all done by hand, literally.
One morning we'd come in and it would be spring. I don't know how, they'd like fairies. And next day, because we were doing all the stuff that was shot there at one go, next day we'd come in, it'd be autumn. They'd sprayed the trees, pulled up the plants. Next day it would be winter. Snow on the ground, icicles hanging.
And there were scenes shot up there when the temperature was over 100 Fahrenheit, which were snow scenes. But there was awful problems with the landscape at the back. We had to roll out miles of white plastic and cover it with white marble dust. And we had to pay attention to the details of frosting up close shots.
For the scenes showing my escape from the Red Troops, David wanted us to really feel the cold of inner Russia. So he took me and the crew to Finland, near the Arctic Circle and 10 miles from the Russian border. And instead of having the Spanish army as extras, we used Lapland gypsies. Here we also celebrated David's 57th birthday. one thing about the location. We didn't have to act cold here. It was often 40 degrees below.
We could not do big scenes, though. It had to be small scenes. But we very much wanted, with our artificial winter, to get a bit of real winter into it. It helped. It was just 2 weeks to get a bit of what you might call as near to Russia as we could get.
But what they hadn't worked out accurately, I mean, is the thickness of the ice. Now, it was very cold. Presumably, the ice was very thick. And we had these kitchens set up, trucks cooking and making tea all day and coffee. And everybody had a heater, you know, for between scenes. We used to sit and put something to heat ourselves. And so what was happening is every day the ice was melting. But we didn't realize quite. And those kitchen trucks kept getting lower and lower. And at some point, there was somebody said, hey, wait a minute, you know, this thing, we could all go right through the ice. And they stuck a thing in to see how much was left. And there wasn't that much left. I mean, it was time to move.
Test 12, take one.
Shooting began in December 1964 and continued through October of 1965. We did the funeral scene first, and David cast my own son, Tarek, to play the part of young Yuri. David chose Nicholas Rogue, a brilliant English cameraman, to be the cinematographer on Zhivago. Nick had been a second unit cameraman on Lawrence. But Lean's demanding sense of aesthetic soon ended their collaboration.
Nick Rogue was the first cameraman, and he was wonderful, but they didn't get on. Nick Rogue had his ideas of how certain scenes should be shot, and David Lean, I overheard one thing once where David Lean was saying, I want all the ugliness done in beautiful light. I want all the killings, that killing in the cornfield of those poor boys who were just schoolboys, military school. He said, I want that to be beautiful, to be dazzling, to be rich, to be light for a love scene. And I want the love scenes in horrible cold. He wanted the contrast. And Nick Rogue couldn't. He wanted to light the love scenes so beautifully and soft. He said, no, I want them hard. And they fought and fought about that, about the moods. And eventually one day there was and Nick Rogue was out and Freddie Young was in.
Freddie Young was the cameraman David and I had worked with on Lawrence. He was a wonderful person and shared David's vision for the film. The film itself was shot in 35mm Panavision. The 70mm Super Panavision process that Lean had used on Lawrence was deemed too expensive.
Look, Sasha.
For this shot of the town of Yuryatin under siege, David had a crew burn 10 tons of old rubber tires. Color was an element that David and John Box used in subtle ways to enhance a scene. For example, the first few times the audience sees the Moscow streets, they appear almost black and white.
We decided to take all the color out of that street. It was monochrome, black and white. It was done on purpose, so the impact of the revolution came the first red flag. Very important.
John Box also painted the front of Strelnikov's train red to make Tom Courtney's character more threatening.
And those details, first red flag, red train, anything you can do, snow blowing, leaves blowing, sunflowers weeping.
This is the sunflower John is talking about. After Lara leaves the hospital, the despondent, love-struck Yuri walks back alone through the room. David had propman Eddie Fowley attach fine threads to the sunflower's petals and pull on them to make it seem as if the sunflower were weeping too. The camera work was also so designed to show how Yuri Zhivago saw the world. David made me play Yuri as an observer.
I want to tell you a story. When I arrived to meet David Lean, he said, I'm going to ask you to do something extremely difficult for an actor to do. I want you to do nothing at all. At all. Not to emote, not to have any reaction, not to do anything at all. And I said, why is that? And he said, because when we were writing the script with Robert, our problem was how to show in a film that a man is a poet. We can't have him reciting poetry to say this man is a poet. So we decided that the whole film would be seen through his eyes. He will be in every scene practically, but it will always be the other person's scene, the other actor's scene. And you have to be patient, you have to do nothing. I used to listen to people who went to see the dailies, the rushes. They used to say, oh, wasn't Julie Christie wonderful? Wasn't Rod Steiger fantastic? Wasn't Tom Courtenay? Wasn't Geraldine extraordinary? They kept speaking about the other actors, and I never heard anyone saying, wasn't Omar wonderful? And I got more and more worried that I wasn't doing anything. And I had a sort of nervous breakdown one night, and I called David Lean, and I said, David, you were wrong. You shouldn't have chosen me. I'm terrible. I'm not doing it right. And he came to see me, which was very rare at night when David would come out of his bed and go and see someone. And he said, you don't trust me. You don't trust me. I told you. He said, you do what I tell you. And if I'm right, all through the film, I don't want anyone to think that Zhivago is wonderful. But if I do it right, when the curtain comes down, they will think of you more than anyone else.
David Lean knew exactly what he wanted for the music of Zhivago. He called on French composer Maurice Jarre, who had scored Lawrence of Arabia, and won an Oscar for that work. Maurice was to win another Oscar for Dr. Zhivago.
And I wrote one theme, and the next morning I said, David, I want to show you something. I play a theme on the piano. And he said, well, Maurice, I think you can do better. I was really disappointed, and I was really, you know. And so I rushed back to my room. I wrote another piece of music. He said, it's too sad. I said, sure. And also, you know, after that, just the time was passing. And a third theme I wrote, and he said, it's too fast. And I was really started to be so down and desperate to find the right thing. And finally he said, Maurice, forget about Zhivago, forget about Russia. You go with your girlfriend to the mountain, because I know you like mountains, and you think about her, and you write a love theme for her. So a weekend I did that, and just I went to the mountain, and then the Monday morning I wrote, and it was really Lara's theme, and he said, that's it.
Maurice wanted to give Lara's theme a Russian sound, so he explored using balalaikas.
Balalaika, it's very, very melodious, but also very takes you like that, just like, you know, it's like almost embracing.
Unfortunately, the MGM Orchestra didn't have any balalaika players on staff.
We couldn't go to Russia, of course, during this time. Dr. Zhivago was no. And somebody one day said, you know, you should go to a church. There is an Orthodox Russian church in Hollywood, and maybe you can ask, maybe you will find some. So I went one Sunday morning. I said, do you know if somebody can play balalaika? And finally, one Russian, very nice guy, said yes. I said, do you think I can have more balalaika, 3-4? He said, yes, how many you want? And he brought this, this little combo. And we rehearsed, and the only problem, these balalaika players, they couldn't read music. So I have to teach them individually, the few 16 bars of the Lara theme, bum, bim, 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 bum, bum. So when we recorded with the orchestra, and I have my 22 balalaika players, and I have to mime, and I was say, and all the orchestra and the balalaika were very, very together, very, very good. But it was really something very, very interesting. I never did this kind of thing before.
The music of Zhivago got the production in trouble one night when General Franco's repressive and arch-conservative police heard the extras singing the Internazionale, the communist anthem.
That was an extraordinary night. We were shooting at night. These thousands of extras had to sing the Internationale, which is the Marxist hymn. They all knew it. This is just after it's not just after the Civil War, but they certainly all knew it. And again, Spain was in this incredibly repressive regime, General Franco, etc. And they were singing with such gusto, marching down and singing as loud as they could. Everyone knew the words. And the police came. The police came really... they thought something very dangerous was happening. And so the first assistant had to explain, no, this is a movie, and it's about Russia, and it's... But the police then, they hung around because they wanted to see who knew that song really well. And so we had to get rid of the police. But apparently all the neighbors in Canillejas, which was the small village where we were shooting, they suddenly, in the middle of the night, because it was about 3 a.m, we did this thing, they woke up and they heard the Internacional. They got out their bottles, popping open their bottles. They thought, God, he's dead. Franco's there, or whatever.
No doubt they'll sing in tune after the revolution.
Costumes tell a story very much, I think, in film.
Phyllis Dalton was our costumer on Zhivago, and she did a wonderful job. I tell you, it wasn't always that easy keeping us actors in our costumes.
Madrid in midwinter is bitterly cold, so that was fine. Everyone was quite glad to have layers of clothes and keep their gloves on and stay properly dressed and not lose their scarves and bits and pieces. But when we were still shooting there by midsummer, one almost became a sort of policeman going around, trying to bully people into keeping all their layers of clothes on, because they really weren't so happy by then. But it had to look the same.
The weather didn't always cooperate either, especially at Soria, where we were supposed to shoot so many of the snow scenes. That year, most unusually, Soria got almost no snow.
So we'd have to be shooting, carrying on in Madrid, and then someone on the telephone in Soria would ring up and say, hey, it's snowing here. So we'd have to drop everything, having just dressed probably 500 of the Spanish army as Russian soldiers, drop everything, hang it all up again, and chase up to Soria, by which time the snow would have melted again. So it was a bit exasperating.
David's attention to detail even carried through to the color of costumes. For example, the pink dress Geraldine wears when she arrives at Moscow Station.
That was a slight argument I had with the director at the time, because I designed that same costume in pale gray and with a black fur hat, because I thought she would be so sophisticated she'd want to go for the utterly grown-up thing, and the rather tight skirt that she could hardly run in, which was very in Paris in those days.
So we went back, and Phyllis Dalton then had a white one made. And it was beautiful, a big white hat and a white, same costume though. And we went out, we said, he has to like this, because I looked as fresh as a snowflake. And he looked at it, and he said, no, it's not. He said, smile. He said, all that white, her teeth look yellow.
David, he didn't say he didn't like it, but he was quite adamant that he wanted a pale colour.
David Lean said pink. And she said, pink? And he said, yes, try pink. And so this gorgeous pink and gray, very soft gray outfit. And it's the most beautiful outfit in the whole film.
Afterwards, I realized how absolutely right he was. I was being too practical. I said, well, she can't come a long train journey all the way from Paris in pale pink. She'll be filthy, you know. But he was right. He usually was.
Lean was just as insistent on the red gown that Julie Christie wears when she dines with Komarovsky, which provoked another costuming crisis.
I've been waiting nearly an hour, Victor.
Phyllis comes to me and says I'm having terrible trouble with this red dress. Julie won't wear it. She hates red, she doesn't want to wear it, she hates it. Can you help? So I go off to try and find, I'm certain she's hiding from me, I can't find her. We're getting quite close to the shooting time. Eventually I find Julie and I say, Julie, what's the trouble with the red dress? She says, I hate it. I feel uncomfortable in it, I feel awful. I said, Julie, that's the point, isn't it? It's not a dress you would have bought or Lara would have bought. Komarovsky bought that dress for Lara and made her wear it. And she doesn't like it. Please play the part in it. She did.
Julie also played her part in the scene where she slapped Komarovsky. I mean, that was scripted. What wasn't scripted was what happened next.
And nobody slaps Komarovsky. And I didn't know. I slapped her right back. But I was a gentleman. I slapped her with my glove. And everybody went like that. And they left it in, you know, because it was a good moment between the two of them.
On the whole, Zhivago accurately reflects the look of Russia in the first part of the century. Yet it seems one detail was overlooked.
Oh, you noticed the hair? The hair is a bit 60s, isn't it? It's so surprising. In that time, in the 60s, it was inconceivable to have your hair flat or to have it... You just didn't. I mean, it was ugly. Julie Christie, I think, more than anyone, has the bangs and this and the sort of loose hair. And I have the beehive.
Because that's another of my pet theories, that however authentic you try to be with a period film, there's always something that gives away the period in which it was made. And it's the women's hair that give it away. And I've thought since then, I'm leaving aside criticism of Julie's hair at the time, but certainly looking at it now, that's exactly what makes it a 60s film. And I'll leave it at that.
After a year of pre-production and almost a year of shooting, there was a furious 8-week stint in the editing room in order to finish the movie in time for Christmas and before the deadline for the 1965 Academy Awards. David, of course, helped edit every frame of the film. And on December 22nd, Zhivago premiered. First reviews were bad. Newsweek said the film had cheap jack sets and pallid photography. Judith Crist called it a spectacular soap opera. The critic's barbs dismayed David to the point where he said he would never shoot another film again.
Oh, it was terrible. The critics were absolutely awful. I mean, I don't think that there was one good review. Some of them were just... oh, terrible. And that hurt David Lean so much. They destroyed him completely. And I said, but David, the film, it's a blockbuster. The public is what's important. The public love it. The buggers hated it. I said, but who, what buggers? The critics. He couldn't get over that.
Now, from the most widely acclaimed novel of our generation, Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer presents David Lean's film,
After the first weeks following the film's release, MGM put on a massive publicity blitz and the film took off, grossing more than $200 million worldwide.
The monumental motion picture of our time.
Mm-hmm. At the Oscars in April 1966, John Box won for the sets, Phyllis for her costumes, Maurice for his music, Freddie Young for his cinematography, and Robert Bolt won for his screenplay. His old friend, David Dean, was there to accept it for him.
I'm terribly, terribly pleased to be able to accept this for Robert. He had a most fiendishly difficult job, and we wouldn't have got the brass to date but for him. Thank you very much.
That year, the best director and best picture went to The Sound of Music.
It because people come up to me in the street and they say, and they used to come up to me in the street and say, oh, Geraldine Chaplin, Dr. Zhivago, my favorite movie. And now they come up to me and they say, oh, Dr. Zhivago, Geraldine, you're in Dr. Zhivago, that's my mother's favorite movie.
In the Soviet Union, Pasternak is now considered one of the greatest poets of all time. Today, his grave is the site of daily poetry readings. In 1988, some 30 years after it was banned, the novel was finally published in the Soviet Union. In April 1994, the film on which it was based premiered there. Today, 30 years after the film's release, the enduring popularity of Dr. Zhivago is a true testament to the storytelling of Pasternak and Lean.
I think more than anything, I think it's the love story that makes that movie. It was the first movie, and as far as I can tell, the only movie that I've seen where you see a man who gets out of his wife's bed into his mistress's bed, out of his mistress's bed into his wife's bed, and where you completely understand it. And even the oldies at the time understood it. They weren't shocked. I mean, no one was shocked. You understood this. And that's very, you have to be very clever to do that.
I like being Dr. Zhivago. I wish I were someone like Dr. Zhivago, because I think he was probably the most perfect person that I have ever heard about. I can't see any defects in him. He was perfect, kind and patient. And strangely enough, my secretary and my housekeeper told me that when I was doing this film, I was much more gentle than I am usually in my normal life. So it's some of it rubbed out on me, I hope.
It's human beings, and that is the strength of Pasternak's book and David's direction. He was trying to really get at the essence of human beings. Again, under very strange circumstances, a revolution. How do you behave? Sadly, it's going on now in the world, too. There must be Zhivago stories going on in Sarajevo, but various other parts of the world. And that is Pasternak again writing it and making us aware of it. And that's why people read his book, and that's why the film was made.